The world has its eyes on this election, but no country is watching it more closely than India. India's diplomats have been navigating a challenging neighborhood. Relations with China and Pakistan remain strained, and that's putting it mildly. Nepal's political shakeup has sparked instability. The situation in the East is even worse, where Bangladesh remains in turmoil. Sheikh Hasina's departure has been a setback for New Delhi. In Myanmar, the junta's grip on power is being challenged by the rebels. Afghanistan has a terrorist regime. The Maldives is a slippery customer that India is trying to work with. Given all of this, the election in Sri Lanka comes at a critical time for India. New Delhi has a significant stake in the stability of Sri Lanka. It would want to see some continuity in policy. Of course, the choice of president rests with the people of Sri Lanka, and New Delhi respects that, but it does have some expectations from the next leader here in the interests of both bilateral ties and regional stability. And topping this list is security and the urgent need to ensure that, especially against the growing Chinese footprint in the region. When Sri Lanka's next president takes oath, in hopefully a few days from now, he'll have an important decision to make about China's so-called research vessels, which are in fact spy ships that become frequent visitors to this island. They have been spotted often in the Indian Ocean. China says that these ships are on research assignments, that they're being used to study the ocean. But ask any expert, any observer, and they'll tell you that China uses these research ships for spying. So this year, Colombo imposed a moratorium. It banned all research vessels from docking in Sri Lanka. So no Chinese ship has docked in Sri Lanka this year, but this won't last, this arrangement, because the moratorium expires in January next year. And the next president could decide to renew it and block all future visits, or he could do away with the restrictions altogether. Needless to say, India would want the moratorium to stay. Or at the very least, New Delhi would want Colombo to help it in keeping this Chinese activity in check. The second point of concern is trade. And again, China is a factor here. There are big-ticket Chinese projects in the pipeline, like the port city Colombo. We've told you about this project before on the show. China is building an entire city here in Colombo. The port city is being built on land reclaimed from the ocean. Beijing has already invested $1.4 billion in this project, and unlike the Hambantota port, there is widespread backing for Port City Colombo. It's a stone's throw from where we are standing. The three top candidates in the presidential race, Ranil Wickremesinghe, Sajith Premadasa, and Anurag Kumaradesanayake, all three support this project. Now, India, however, feels differently. Reports say that New Delhi has reservations about this project, and for good reasons. Sri Lanka would like to see Indian companies invest in Port City, but India remains wary. It is said to have made counter proposals to boost investment in Sri Lanka and develop its critical infrastructure. So this is the second area of concern for India, the trade. The next president will have to find a way to strike a balance and address India's concerns and ensure a level playing field. The third point is Sri Lanka's economy and its long-term stability that depends on the economy. Colombo cannot afford to repeat the mistakes of the past. It has creditors to answer to. In 2022, when its economy had collapsed, many countries offered support, countries other than India and China. Sri Lanka has borrowed money from the likes of Japan and France as well, and all these creditors would like to see a stable and sound economic policy to keep supporting Sri Lanka's economic recovery. India is hoping for the next leader to be sensitive to all of this. At the same time, it is engaging with all key players because at the end of the day, a bilateral relationship is with a country and its people, not the individuals who hold power. Earlier this month, Ajit Doval was in Sri Lanka. He is India's national security advisor. And Doval met with all the leading presidential candidates separately. He had one-on-one meetings with them. And this is a good approach. Whoever wins this election, India will have to find a way to work with them, because not doing it is not an option. The stakes are simply too high.
Other billionaires,